Thanks, Morgan. We've been really busy this time. Let me get my screen shared. There's the screen share. All right. Lots of great stuff this time. So, we'll go through all of it. So, I want to start off though by thanking everybody who was able to contribute this time. We had I'll scroll down to the bottom here. We had contributions from five different organizations this time. So always great to call that out. So Bywater, of course, we did lots of good stuff. CW Mars, one of the libraries that we're working with, one of their developers had some code contributions related to Evergreen. James Staub was doing some independent development, a couple of cool features that he built this time. Alexander from PTFS Europe contributed some cool code too, some summon stuff. And Lucas from TechA also did lots of good stuff. So thanks everybody for contributing. Certainly makes the community what it is and like really helps us build amazing things. So thank you, thank you. With that, let's dive into it. So let's start by looking at donations. So with donations, we added the ability, or this was actually Lucas from TechA added the ability to allow users to enter their address when making a donation. So we have a new option there that's letting them do that. If that's checked on, what you will get is on the donation form, this had it with it checked off. Let me refresh. And there, let me refresh and make sure that I had actually saved this. This was, so there's allowing the user to make their donation. And did I break this? I did break this. I apologize. This was working yesterday. So what this will show is your address information right underneath the donation where you can say, enter your street address, your so address one, address two with city, state, zip. And apologize that, that I broke that. Sorry, Lucas. That's my bad. Let's see. Yeah, that is saved. Let's just update this and make sure that is saved. Refresh that. That does. Save. Yep, my bad. I goofed that up. Let's go on. That will work later today when we deployed all of the test servers. So Evergreen, and this is again an area where Jason from CW Mars did lots of help with us on this. So a couple of things that we can call out. So I'm not really going to demo, but we'll talk about. So there's copy notes within Evergreen per item. So you can add notes and tags. People are using these for things like book plates, for information about like here's like usage restrictions or that kind of thing on the actual items. Those were previously exporting as part of the mark export, but when we went to look at the API, those weren't available. So Jason actually did some work in Evergreen to allow those to export. And then we also did work in Aspen to bring those in as part of the API. We also worked on the fine display that I'll show. So we just wanted to update a little bit more of the fine information. So we now have more information about what happened with it. So, so in this case, we're showing the, in this case, CW Mars Hotel is the name of the title, and the CW Mars is the author. So you can see title and author now for lost materials instead of just saying, "Hey, this is lost. You lost something." So that's really cool. We're really happy to have that. James did some work on hidden series. So the idea here, so I'm going to explain what this is first. So, well, we can see it here. We've got some different series that people are like, yes, that is a series. But we don't really want that indexed or displayed. It's not really relevant. These ones, the classics are cool. We've got some that are just like, if you look at like, refresh that page. So like some of the Thorndike large prints and those are not typically all that useful because it doesn't really apply to everything. So like London Large and Severn House large print and the Thorndike Press large print core, those are just they're series that aren't super useful. So people want to be able to get rid of those from the index. So we now have the ability within the hidden series. This is under cataloged and grouped works. We're going to add, and we'll just say, we don't want to see Thorndike large print core. Let's do maybe a couple of these. Large search. So let's also get rid of this large print series. So we'll apply that. So let's select these so that we can see those five titles. Yeah, we can get rid of the Penguin Classics and all of those that we just don't really care about and our patrons don't care about. So we'll add that. We'll add another one. Then this will take overnight to index normally. However, if you want to, you can always force a reindex. So we can go into our staff view. We can say force a reindex, and that title will then be indexed again. So this will happen in a couple of minutes when the indexer runs. So if I talk slowly enough here, maybe we will refresh and this will be gone. Or maybe it'll take a couple of minutes. So we'll come back and refresh the page there in a minute. But yeah, super cool feature. Nice, just great way to clean things up, especially when we're getting those series and stuff from some of the e-content vendors that they've got them because they need them, but we don't really want them. Moving on, so that was Hidden Series. We also have had, so for people that are determining format based off item type, we'll have a few cases where people will say like, hey, I really want like my reference books to be called out by item type, but then I want everything else to be done by bib. Or maybe I've got my Lucky Day collection that I need to call out by item day, by item type, but everything else is just book. I don't want to have to catalog that or catalog the large print differently, and we'll just figure those out by the bib record. What it was doing was saying like, hey, if we had a case where we had three items and two of them had, we were able to determine the format based off the item type. The other one, we just kind of assumed that it was the same as the rest if it wasn't. So we'd say, yeah, all three of those must be Lucky Day books because two of them were. Or maybe even if we have 10 of them, we're going to assume that all 10 are Lucky Day books, even though only one of them was a Lucky Day. So we updated to say, instead of making that assumption, go through, check the bib record, and get all of that for everything else. So nice way to make that format determination even easier. So that's cool. The other big thing we did with indexing is we're upgrading to Solr 8. We're a little behind on Solr versions. We're hoping to get some cool new features. The latest version is actually Solr 9. But in order to get there from Solr 7 that we were on, we actually have to go Solr 7 to Solr 8 to Solr 9. So in another month or two, we will see going to Solr 9. And then we'll be able to do some neat stuff. As part of that, we're also upgrading our Java version. We have so far seen some decent performance improvements to indexing. So some of the indexes where a full index would take 16 or 18 hours, they're down to maybe more like 12. We still want to get that shorter even, but nice that we're seeing some performance improvements, and hopefully we'll see even better performance improvements when we go to Solar 9. We might also have some other tricks up our sleeve. We'll see how we do with that as things go. Let's just refresh this and see if that's gone away. No, our indexer's a little slow today. It's probably actually coming from a Hoopla record, which would take overnight as well, because that only runs once a day normally. Let's look at location. So last time Jordan was showing some of the work that Kirsten had done in Lita on the locations pop-up page. So we did that now. So if you add an image and have your address and all of that good stuff set up, we can say in your hours and locations page, this updates to look a lot like it does in Lita. So it's a really nice looking page. You get the map, you get the image, you get more information about hours and that kind of thing, which is really awesome. So nice work there. Let's see, Koha updates. Again, this is something that James contributed. So we now have the ability to index course reserves. So from Koha. So we previously could pull course reserves from Symphony. We've updated to do it with Koha as well. So if we go into our beta library, we would go down to the course reserve section. And here we can see, like, do we allow searching course reserves or not? You also have to set up course reserves here to define your settings. So here we're going to say, yeah, we do want to search course reserves. We're going to search location M. Settings. So as Jordan put in the chat, so if you're using course reserves for your items on display, you just won't set it up to be searchable. So it's not going to pull in automatically. But you will be able to, if you're an academic institution that is using course reserves, you will be able to search them there. So that hasn't indexed just yet. So let's give that a few minutes to index as well, since we just set that up. We'll move on to talking about Open Archives. So Open Archives, we've done a bunch more work on that. So we have the ability now, we added a new facet. We added the location facet that some of the archives will export that. We've also added the ability to index out of mods. So it's just a different data format. We had been doing Dublin Core that was working for pretty well everybody, but we found a new collection that only supported mods. So those are kind of the two big archives formats. So those are now available. We've got an example here of that. So here we've got the location facet as well as mods records, and they're a little hard to see here. We also did do some work on pulling images from a different from additional locations. So new ways to try to bring those in automatically. So more good stuff there. So that's archives. Additional work on Palace Project. So let's look at Palace Project search in. So we've updated Palace Project so that if we look at the e-content collection, we're going to prefix now the main collection from Palace Project. So we have the ability to say this is a Palace Marketplace or let's just do a blank search. So here we've got Palace Bookshelf, Palace Marketplace. There's BiblioBoard, so you have the option. All of those different collections will pull in, and then as people are familiar with the different ones, they can search those. So we've also added the ability to interact with the account functionality. So we have the ability to say, hey, let's place a hold on that Palace Project title. So righty, that's being slow today for some reason. Okay, well, let's check out a title. So let's just do a blank search. So that will pop up again. Something must have happened there. We'll take a look at that this afternoon and see why. So let's find go look at our Palace Marketplace. Let's check this title out. So here we go. We see that that was successfully checked out. We can look at our checkouts. This will then load all of our checkouts from physical materials, Libby, Hoopla, et cetera, Palace Project, Cloud Library, Boundless. So if we go into Palace Project, we can see all of the things that we have checked out. I must really like Pride and Prejudice. Because I've got it checked out twice. With that, we then have the ability to also see holds. So here that hold did go through, it looks like. I just didn't get the confirmation. And with that, then we're able to cancel it, have the while you wait functionality, all of that kind of things. So really cool. With that, because so Palace Project, unfortunately, all of the app stores are making it difficult to link to other apps. Like universally, we see this. So instead of having open online kind of functionality like we do with Libby, because you need the app, we have the ability to display instructions. So if we click Palace Project instructions, we'll get instructions for how to use those materials. We have kind of some default text, but of course, that can be overridden however you want. This is a big block of text. So the normal translation functionality isn't going to really work for that. Normally, the translation functionality, it'll handle a long sentence or so, but won't really do anything bigger than that. Certainly won't handle putting images in, or at least it's not designed to do that. So we have within the Palace Project settings. So we go through, we set up our settings. We also now have instructions for using the Palace Project. So this is the text that pops up when you click on that link. We have the ability to translate this into any language that you would want. So I'm just going to do a quick English to English translation because, of course, we can do English to English translations. So we'll click over to English. We're going to say copy that from the default. And then I'm just going to make some little updates. So I'm just going to like, I really prefer that those are centered. And I'm going to just bold some text just to do something. And we're going to say choose beta from the alphabet selection. And we'll bold that so that we can give a little bit more information. And maybe we don't call it library card number, we call it pin or something. So just a little more information there so that you can customize to your library. We'll save that. And then when we go through and look at our Palace Project instructions, it's now going to give us the new one. If we were in a different language, you could also customize that. So you can go through and translate that for all of the different languages you support. So should be a really cool way to do that. We are looking at doing this in other places. So some of those big blocks of text that have been hard to translate in the past, we're looking at making those easier to translate in the future. So moving on from that. So we also added integration with the USPS to do some address validation. This is some cool work that Cody's been doing. So basically, they've got a free API that allows you to validate that an address is correct or was entered correctly. This is going to apply to self-registration forms as well as contact information. So the general idea here is if I go through and enter something wrong, 123 Main Street, then update our contact information, it's going to tell me, no, that's not actually a valid address. So please check your address and try again. Then you can re-enter your information. Same thing with self-registration. So nice way to help make sure that you're getting valid information. So for email addresses, it will validate that the format is correct. We can't validate that the email itself is valid. But if there was an API to do that, that'd be cool to look at. But we haven't heard of a way to do that. So this is just mailing addresses right now as a way to update your physical mailing address, either through self-registration or for updating contact information. It will not validate that if you don't have a USPS key on that, but otherwise it will. Next, we so PTFS Europe provided a search in summon. So we now have the ability to say, so previously we've been able to do articles and databases from EBSCO and EBSCOhost. Now this works very similar to that. So if we search articles and databases for summon, and typically you're only going to have one of those turned on, but if you are a summon user, this is going to be available now. So we can search for solar power. Do a search in articles and databases. So then we get all of that. We get our facets so that we're able to narrow down what we want. So maybe we want to look at all of the patents related to solar power. We can do that. We can say, well, we only want the English ones. And you can do additional subjects if you want to. So we could look for solar heat systems. And then clicking on any of those will take us over to Summon where we can read that. So we can read through that patent and get all of the information. So pretty cool. If you are using Summon, this is early version. So we're kind of looking for, if you have it, we'd love some help testing with that. With your information. Otherwise, PTFS Europe will be doing some more testing with it. But it's looking really good. Other things, more self-registration. So we've updated the self-registration just to allow different sections to be defined. So make it a little easier to read, make it easier for patrons to understand. So break it up by library identity, main address for the Symphony self-registration forms. And that's defined in the self-registration settings. You can kind of choose which location you would like it to be in. So like, for example, if you said, hey, I don't really want a separate address, I will just put everything in contact information. We could do that. So we can move those things around. Those will all move down to that. So we're still working on the ability to copy self-registration forms. We're not done with everything there. We're going to definitely do more work on that in the next version, so 2403. The last thing I wanted to talk about was related to web forms. So we now have the, let's go to, so with custom forms, we now have a few new add new form. So we have a few new fields that we can add. So we can add fields for address, address to, city, state, zip that can all be pre-filled based off the active user's address. So a nice way to just kind of help patrons go through and do that. So previously you could prompt somebody for their address, city, state, zip, just by entering a text field. These just automatically pre-fill for you. So ways to make that all easier for people. I think that is the not updates in an instant for discovery. I'm going to pass it over to Jordan to talk through Lita updates because got a lot there too.
You do. It's super exciting. While I get my screen shared, I'll talk about a few of the things that we fixed that you won't necessarily see. A couple, just little things that people reported. One is with the translate with the loading screen after you've logged in. What it's really doing is loading, getting Lita ready. We changed it so loading translations for those phrases happens earlier so that you can see those translations. And this is how people were updating the text that you see with the loading screen. We had a lot of requests for that. We also did a number of UI changes, fixes, making sure that the correct version of a book cover was showing. We had some audiobook covers showing. The button texts are working really well inside the buttons. Buttons are showing in the screen no matter the size of the screen, as well as that dark mode is just as consistent as light mode. We also did a fix for the notification screen to make sure that when you enable all notifications, that it actually does exactly what it's supposed to do, which is enable all notifications. With that out of the way, now on to the fun stuff. Mark showed you that now within Discovery, we have a much prettier library page to show off your library. We did that in Lita last month, but what we added this month is the ability to view all locations. So previously in Lita, you could only view your local location. So if you saw what I did right there, where I clicked on view all locations here, you can now switch between the individual locations. We did get a little image of that up here. We do have a bug you can see right now with these images and how they're loading. Don't worry about that. We're going to fix that. Same thing like Mark was saying. We're aware of it. We're just working on it to make sure the correct image shows. But I'll go ahead and click into main library. And then this is the screen you saw last time. One other way that you can get into viewing all locations, and this is for an individual library or a consortium, is to go down here and to view all locations, and that takes you back to this screen. The next thing that we did is event integration into Lita. I would say that this is our first pass at it, the basic features. So what I want all of you to see is what we've done today. And then if you have ideas on more things we can do for event integration, like please let us know, please put in a ticket, please come to the community meeting to talk about it, because I'm sure we'll be doing more with events in the future, but I'll show you what we have now. So a typical thing that folks would search for that maybe are looking for event, use it all the time, is story time. So I'll go ahead and search for that. And then we don't have anything like the Explore More bar yet. That's where we're still thinking how exactly are the different entry points into this. But what you can do is instead of searching in the library catalog here, you click on events. Now, this is going to completely reload your search results. Obviously, they're events. It's also doing things in the background like reloading the filters to make sure that the filters are the same. Because if you think about an Aspen Discovery, the filters for events when you're searching events are different than the filters for materials. So we get our list of events just like we do in Discovery. I'll go ahead and open one for you. And again, this works for all of our event integrations. The features match what you would see in Discovery. So if we're able to pull over the image from, I think this, if we're able to pull over the image, then we can pull the image over from your event platform. We can take you to more information. The more information button here just opens it up in the native event platform, the same page that you would see right there. If within Discovery, you have it set to bypass this screen or this page in Discovery, it will go directly to that more info. But from here, you can actually do a couple of other things. One of the things that I like that is special to Leda, if you look at the date right here, you can actually add it to your calendar directly from Aspen or from Leda, excuse me. You also have the your events functionality, so you can add it to your events right here. And then now it says in your events. I can click into in your events. And it says I don't have any saved upcoming. Oh, that one should actually show. It should show right here. It just sometimes takes a minute to show. Let's go back to Discovery, where we were. You can also add it to a list. So we have a number of different lists right here. Again, works the same way as anything else, the way that you can add anything to a list within Discovery. Let's see what else. I think I got everything on this page. Let's go back and just show you a few more of the filters. So I can go ahead and click on branch. You know, we pulling all the different branches. We have a couple of different demo sites in here or pulling in from a couple different places. So if you recognize some of these branch names, we're just using it for test data. So now it's showing the branch is the Salina Public Library, and all of these are from Salina Public Library. So those are our really fun Leda updates. And let me see, do we have any chat questions? I have a question. Any news of ACIBET calendars being integrated? We are actually meeting with ACIBET in the next few weeks to talk about that. So that's how that one's moving forward. But I'll go ahead and stop sharing and turn it over to Morgan.